Form layout is a crucial element of form design that many designers and website managers neglect and often leave to the last stage of development. Since the form is the key method in which you'll be interacting with your users, you want to consider and plan for the physical structure of the form prior to building it. You don't need labels for your form to work, but it can be considered an accessibility crime not to use them. Labels are what signify what the input box is for, and it associates them together. The use of the label tag is not only semantically correct, but it gives you the opportunity to style them uniquely with CSS. Labels are not help text. Use succinct, short, descriptive labels, just a word or two, so that users can quickly scan your form. Here's what we're going to be building right now. This is an unstyled form. Everything that you see here is being controlled by the browser. If I expand the browser, you can see that the form fields are going to change the position, and that's because the items currently are inline items. We'll go ahead and create some custom CSS so we can transform this plain form into something that's going to be visually much more appealing and more user-friendly. Let me familiarize you with the HTML code. I have an HTML page, and you can see that I have a form tag. My methods is set to post. There's a field set and a legend. The field set is the area that is going to encompass all of these input fields, and the legend is the text that labels that area. Most of my input tags are paired with a label. The label is tied to the input tag because the value of the for attribute matches the ID. Generally, I usually have the label appearing first and then the input tagged. This is the same for the text area element as well. If we scroll down a little further on the page, you can see that I have a div with a class of checks. That's because I'm using an input with a type of checkbox. So I want to be able to style this element a little bit differently. The other thing I want to point out is the input tag should appear first and the label should appear second. That's because when you're looking at checkboxes or radio buttons, you want the check or radio to be first and then the text that describes it to come second. So we'll flip the order of these elements for checkboxes and for radio buttons. The second div also has a class of checks, and this is where I'm creating my radio buttons. Finally, I have a submit input type that will allow the user to submit the form, and then I just close the rest of the HTML tags. Let's go ahead and let's create some CSS. I have a code snippet file. This is going to contain the code that we'll be using to style our form. The first section that we're going to be styling is our field set and legend section. So I'm just going to copy these lines of code. I'll go back to my CSS file and paste them in. If we save the page and come back out to the browser and refresh, you can see that our form is already looking a little bit better. The field set now is styled with rounded corners. The color and the thickness of the line is a little bit different than the default. We have some padding and margin as well, and we're also setting a minimum width on this element. As you can see, the legend has also been styled with some specific formatting that will allow this to work better. I'll go back to my code snippet page, and now we'll go ahead and style the labels. So I'm going to copy the label section of my code snippets. I'll go back into the CSS, paste this in, let's save, and then we'll go ahead and refresh. As you can see, with the labels, I'm defining the labels to be block level elements. That will force the input or text area to appear underneath that particular element. Now, I don't want this behavior to be occurring on my checkboxes, so we'll have to go ahead and reformat that in a little bit. I also have a rule for label first of type and a margin set to 0. I want to override the top margin, so that's the space that we're getting in between these elements. But on the first item, I don't want that extra spacing, so I'm removing it with the first of type. The next step is to style our inputs. Let's go back to the code snippet file. I'm going to copy the area that contains the inputs and text area. We'll go back to our CSS and paste that in. I'll save, and let's refresh in the browser. As you can see, the input elements are now a little bit larger, and they're easier to click into because we have more space. If we reference our CSS, all I've really done on the inputs is to style the border and to add some padding. I also have a specific rule that is targeting the email and the text inputs. I wanted these to be wider than the phone input. So I went ahead and declared a width on those two elements. Then we have our text area styles. This is setting a min height, min width, some padding, and addressing the border as well. Now let's go ahead and style our checkboxes and radio buttons. I'll go back into my code snippet file and I'll copy this section of code. In the CSS, I'm going to paste this in. We'll save and let's refresh. So I have some rules where I'm setting margin on the bottom of checks. That's just creating spacing in between any checks div. Then I have a rule on checks P, which is removing the margin bottom. Oftentimes, I would have a more general rule that would style paragraphs and put spacing at the bottom. So because I want the spacing to be close to the radio buttons, I've removed that. Then I'm using some attribute selectors to select checkboxes and radio input types. And we are going ahead and getting the label of those elements. So we're telling the labels, if they are descendants of checkbox and radio, to be inline block, to have no padding and no margin. We want to style these inputs differently than the inputs that we have above. Then I have an input type for radio that is just setting some margin on the left. That's creating a little bit of space between our radio button choices. And then we have an input for the radio button that is the first. We don't want that margin on the left to appear on the first one. Now our input and checkboxes are styled more to my liking. We'll go back to our code snippets and we will customize the submit button. So I'm going to select this code right here. I'll paste this into my CSS file and save. And back here in the browser, when we refresh, you can see that the contact us button has now been styled more uniquely. And finally, I have a little bit of code that is going to be for larger screens. So let's just copy this. I'll go back to my CSS file and paste this in. And if we save the file, and before I refresh, I just want to show you what my form looks like when the page gets really big. The text area element gets way too long. So let's make some adjustments here. If I refresh the page, as you can see, the width of my form has now been adjusted. I have a width on the field set of 40%. So if the screen gets bigger, the form will increase, but not as substantially as it did before. And then, of course, it does work in a responsive way and shrinks down. I have set a minimum width as well, so it never gets smaller than this size at a large screen. And let's go ahead on our field set and just add a little bit of margin auto so that we can center this element. Perfect. All right, when we do some basic styling on our form elements, we can really transform the form so that it is much more appealing and easier for our users to be able to fill out and utilize.